Hello there, YouTube. This is Tiki Bomber here. Before I go right into what I'm going to go into today, I'm going to first and foremost say thank you to everybody who does follow me either on YouTube or Twitter. You probably see me do some stupid things on Twitter, and you know, when I actually do fuck up, which I've done a lot, I would go ahead and apologize for my fuck ups. Which, you know, makes sense. You fuck up, you apologize for that fuck up. And that's part of what I'm actually going to talk about with today. It's a follow-up to the Sargon vs. Anita article that I read to you yesterday. And this is what Hank Green, one of the co-founders, I guess it's a co-founder, for the VidCon 2017 convention that took place just over this weekend. Alright. It sounds like it might be some good things, because this is coming from one of the two people in charge of actually running everything. Now, before I go into further details about this, Sargon of Akkad has actually posted up that it is, in fact, against the code of conduct for VidCon for any panelists to use their position of power, you know, at a panel, to conduct any form of harassment, abuse, assault, etc., etc. Which is what Anita was blatantly seen in doing when she was given her chance to speak, called out Sargon as being a garbage human and a shithead for his video content, because he is criticizing hers and several other feminists up on that panel's viewpoints. She has stated in her own article that he is a threat to women all over the internet. And honestly, I don't really think Sargon is a threat to women. Yeah, he's a threat to her narrative that women are victims. And as long as women believe that they will forever be victims, that puts her in that powerful position. That gives her her money. That gives her her patrons, which is about $20,000 per month versus Sargon's $5,000 a month. Like, that was one of the things she was talking about in her article, is that he's getting paid to harass women online. And I'm putting this out there right now. Sargon's never said anything to me, harassing or otherwise. He's never addressed me personally. He's never, in my opinion, said anything that is against women's rights as a whole. What he has stated is that Anita is not a real gamer in his videos. Thunderfoot has done the same thing. Undoom has possibly done the same thing. Bearing's done the same thing. Andy Worski's done the same thing. Roaming Millennial's done the same thing. Video game developers done the same thing. I've done the same thing. You know, this is like beyond beating the dead fucking horse. This is like poking at the dead horse's grave with a sharpened stick to continue to beat it at this point. All right? The fact that so many people, myself included, are saying that Anita's videos are garbage, and the reason why they are garbage, and her viewpoints about how misogynistic game culture really is compared to the actual facts about game culture in general, shows how shallow she really is and how low she will go. However, I don't want to focus too much attention on Anita on today's video, as this is not just Anita who sees this. Hank Green, which is one of the people in the VidCons, like I said, I think he and John Green both co-founded VidCon 2017, had put out a code of conduct that Anita had blatantly broken. And this is the response that we get from him in general. And again, I'd like to thank Twitter, especially Rin Michaels. If you guys don't know who she is, go fucking follow her. I do occasionally talk with her. You can find her at Rin Michaels. She had actually posted this up in a screen cap to somebody else. But, you know, I saw it. I read it. I'm like, yeah, this is fucking stupid. I also saw what John Green had to say in general. And yeah, it is fucking stupid. And this is my opinion as to why it's stupid, but let me go ahead and read. Many people in these communities end up believing the righteous thing to do is threaten, harass, and dox the thinkers they're arguing with. Whether or not this is an intentional strategy to cultivate harassment or an awful side effect, the result is some of the worst disclosure and most intense harassments on the internet. This year, we have contingent of attendees, some who paid, some who snuck in with fake passes, who had been either perpetrators of this harassment or had, for years, watched as the outrage they cultivated resulted in following, doxing, harassing, intimidating, and even threatening the lives of the creators on these panels. I'm going to pause it right there because it's a two-way street. Just because somebody's up on a panel doesn't mean that they're the automatic victim. I mean, I didn't go to VidCon. I faced harassment online and offline in general. So that statement alone doesn't make any sense. Just because the people on the panel are talking about harassment doesn't necessarily mean that they're the only people who suffer with harassment. Harassment in general is an all-around thing. Everybody has at one point or another dealt with harassment, either online or in real life, or in my case, both. All right? You cannot avoid it because people are going to disagree with your opinion. And as I've told somebody else, you know, everyone at least has one opinion. You know, they're like assholes. Everybody has an opinion. Yeah, everybody has at least one opinion. I would have multiple opinions about multiple different things. But the point is, I do have opinions. People are going to disagree with my opinion. Okay, that's fine. They can disagree with my opinion if they want. I'm not going to change their mind anytime soon. They're definitely not going to change my mind. It does not hurt to be aware of the other side of the argument, which Anita Sarkeesian does not want to address when her comment in her own article was, yeah, well, the one thing that they love to do to discredit the threats that women face online is by saying everyone faces harassment in general in one way or another. That alone is discrediting harassment as a whole. Not just to women, but to minors who use the internet, to men who use the internet, to your grandparents who use the internet, to the gender fluid community of like 7 billion genders. You know, it's not just women who face harassment on a daily basis. Everybody faces harassment in one way, shape, or another. It is difficult to imagine that this group of people who were aware that their channel has been base camps for years of harassment of some of our panelists did not realize that their arriving early to fill up the three front rows of a panel was going to be intimidating. In any case, it looked like an intentional intimidation to most people in attendance, and the panelists were understandably on edge throughout the discussion. I really did not hear or see Anita or any of the other panelists, such as Francesca Ramsey and Kat Black, feeling intimidated. Because let me put it this way, if you're intimidated, one of two things is going to happen. You're going to do something stupid, which, well, I guess Anita would have been intimidated because, hey, Sargon of Akkad's here. That's intimidating. So you're going to do something stupid, like call him out, which she did, and call him an aggressive thing, which she did, or you would have actually, as a real victim for feminism, stood up, walked away, and not said a single damn word. You know, that would have been the one of two things that would have happened on that, is that you would have either called him out like you did, or walked away. Anita, you were literally the only person who really felt any threat of intimidation. And as I pointed out before in my last video, you weren't really intimidated. In fact, it seemed more like you were grabbing at attention to stay relevant to the feminist community. You're not a relevance. In fact, you're a disrelevance. You are so unimportant that you're hurting the feminist credibility. You and, well, Kat Black's no longer a feminist, but many other feminists who use the victimhood status to keep getting your pockets lined with cash and to stay relevant in the public eye discredits the rest of the feminist community, which is what feminism could be doing and how they could be bettering women. Not, oh, You're a sexist, you're a harasser, you're a misogynist, you're a racist, you're a transphobe, you know. In your words alone, Anita, you said everything is misogynistic, everything is transphobic, everything is racist, everything is harassment, and you have to point it all out. No, you don't. A lot of the times, the context is none of that. Like, I'm pretty certain 70% of the time when I tell somebody hello, I'm not being sexist, I'm not being transphobic, I'm not being racist, I'm not harassing people. Hello usually just means hello. And I'm fairly certain 100% of the time, when somebody says hello, they're either trying to greet you or get your attention. And when it's trying to get your attention, it's about 20% of the time. I'm only saying about in my rational perspective of human communications, because hello has always meant one of two things. To greet someone or to get their attention. Hello, hi, yes, may I please have your name? No? Okay. Now then, Green Hawk himself, or Hawk Green, I don't know why I call him Green Hawk. Hawk Green himself has said, sorry this took so long, lots to think about, a statement from VidCon about two popular creditors and harassment. So this is from Hank Green himself. Creditors getting kicked out. Here's our current procedure works. When creator starts getting mobbed at VidCon, we do our best to give them the opportunity to meet their fans by doing some one-on-one, some on-the-spot crowd control. If the mob is getting too big, we ask the creator come to the security to the a back house area where we discuss whether we can set something up or whether it's best for them to leave or just hang out with folks backstage. Alright, yeah, there were some people kicked out because of overpopularity. Like, literally, they had their wristbands cut and everything and couldn't get back into the con. These are people who actually paid for their tickets to get into the con. VidCon has a tagline, because this is the Who's Harassing Whom section here. Has a tagline. It's for people who love online video. But of course, in addition to celebrating this event, has also always been out confronting difficult issues our community faces. It is openly known that women on the internet are subjected to far greater amounts and intensity of harassment and abuse than men. No. And I will go ahead and put in the reason why that is in the description below. Thanks to the Pew Research for 2014 or 15's harassment of conduct. In fact, men face bigger harassment than women do. Men just don't report it as often as women do. Big difference! This is a pattern and is pervasive. Running this event, we have to be aware when a creator has potentially dangerous harassers or stalkers. And our list of our female creators is a whole lot longer than our list of male creators. Probably because you ended up inviting a lot more tits than dicks, maybe? Probably because a lot more tits than dicks got in for some reason? You know, like Anita Sarkeesian, who makes $20,000 a month to bully gamers online, to harass gamers in her videos, and call them misogynistic scumbags, and tell them how blatantly sexist they are when they're not? That's just the one reason why we had a panel called Women Online, featuring women who have received a variety of kinds of abuse, from repeated sexual advances to stalk to stalking to years of targeted harassment. There is a fairly prominent genre of social political commentary on the internet that focuses on specific individuals as a path to attack ideals and build outrage. Yeah, that would be Anita Sarkeesian with her feminist frequency, damsels in distress, or tropes versus video games, or whatever that fucking gamer critic wannabe wants to classify her videos as. You know, specific individuals and attack ideas and build outrage, because that's literally what she does. That's what she does. She attacks individuals, or she attacks the ideas that video games are in fact inherently misogynistic when they're not, and build an outrage because of it. To the point that she actually she's taken off any form of criticism against her as being harassment. And I've already pointed out that there is a difference between harassment and a criticism. Criticism, if you guys don't know, would be something stating that you don't like what they are having to say and explaining why you don't like what they're saying. Harassment would be things like, you're a fucking dumb bitch. Which is actually kind of true for that camel, but different topic and different story. These creators do not violate harassment policies, but the results is often that the vitriol of their followers ends up focused not on ideas, but on people, usually women. Again, that's because women like Anita Sarkeesian open themselves up to this kind of shit. They're not excused from criticism. Nobody is excused from criticism. I could sit here right now and piss off the entire Muslim or Islam nations, all Islamic states, by saying Muhammad was a fucking hack. And then YouTube deletes my channel. This year, we held a contingent of attendees, some who paid, some who snuck in with fake passes, who have been either perpetrators of the harassment or had for years watched as the outrage they cultivated results in following doxing, harassing, intimidating, and even threatening the lives of the creators. So we read all that before. During the panel, a panelist called out one of the audience members for being someone who has made her life very difficult and wished she didn't have to give him attention because he was a human garbage. Okay, Green, this is where you fuck up. You could have simply said what I would have been saying at this point. Ignore him. Continue on with your statement. Ignore him. The fact that she called him out as being human garbage and a shithead is giving him attention. And it gave her attention in return. You know, the same kind of attention that suicide attention seekers use. They use a negative form, something that's very serious, mind you, to garner attention. She used abuse attention. Okay, I'm going to abuse this guy because he's always abused me and get more attention from it. He's never, if I remember right, I'm not 100% certain. My memory is actually very foggy. Sargon's done about 20 videos maybe on Anita in his past 5 years. So that's maybe 4 videos a year on Anita alone. That's, yeah, like I said, beating that dead horse's grave at this point. Look, we don't want our panelists to insult our audience members, even when we completely understand that the comment exists in a much broader and pretty messed up context. Even when people have said hateful things that everyone in our office disagrees with, we have a policy, and it exists, not just to protect people at the show, but to protect our ability to have these conversations. And you failed, and this is how you failed. Our founder, Hank Green, talked with our panelists and said 2 things. He told her that her comment had violated our policy, but that he understood that there were a broader context, which, to be clear, we were blissfully ignorant of until this weekend and remain inexpert in. Okay. Yeah, she violated the policy, but it's okay. No! It's not okay! I'm gonna tell you now! This is why it's not okay, because if I went to this panel and I asked one of these questions, let's just say, Anita, do you feel that you're ready to be open to criticism? And she tells me no, that would be considered harassment to her. If I went to this panel, heard her call him human garbage, stood up and told her what she just did proves the very existence of harassment that exists in general because she creates it, I would be told to leave, even though I paid to sit in this panel to listen to these people talk. If I was to say something against Anita, I would be facing the consequences of it, not because I'm a woman, not because I'm a feminist, but because I disagree with the way she did things. I disagree with how she talks about video games and how she criticizes video gamers. Like, literally, why the fuck did you have this two-bit face lying cunt in this panel to begin with? Oh, I face online harassment. I face online harassment too. I wasn't invited to go to this panel. I wasn't even invited to go to VidCon. I didn't put any money or ask for any funding to go because I'm not that type of person as well. If I want to go somewhere, I actually put effort to get the money. Like, I would have been working my ass off for this money to just show up at the convention alone. Yeah, I'm not a big YouTube star, but I definitely would have sat in that panel. And the second she said something, I would have called her a fucking lying feminist. And told her exactly why she doesn't deserve to be calling herself a feminist. To her fucking face. And you know what? I give Sargon a lot of credit. He restrained himself. Yeah, he tweeted it out. LOL just got called human garbage by Anita Sarkeesian. Like, literally. That's all. And it was caught on camera. He never said anything. He only sat down to listen to what women of the internet were going to say about online harassment that we deal with on a daily basis. He apologized to her for not having been more aware of and active in understanding the situation before the event, which resulted in her being subjected to a hostile environment that she had not signed up for. Like I said, the environment itself is not hostile. You want to know about a hostile environment? How about I drop your ass in front of, in Iraq during the war? Just drop you with a parachute, few perishable, non-perishable items, a weapon, a small case of bullets for ammunition, a bayonet, and a helmet. Yeah, just drop you. Because that is a hostile environment. Sitting at a panel to listen to people bitch about how women get harassment online more often than men, when statistics prove otherwise, is not a hostile environment. In fact, if you literally think it's a hostile environment by that point, then next year, don't do any panels, because that point, you're literally saying all your panels are a hostile environment. You are saying that she is being subjected to a hostile environment. She had the choice to not acknowledge him at all or to leave. Instead, she chose option 3, which was acknowledge him, which she didn't want to, and gain so much negative attention on herself that she feels relevant and important again. And you fed into that fucking ego by apologizing to her. Not only that, that's not even all of it. You apologized to the victimizer, not the victim. As a feminist, I could say several things that would make people laugh and go, wow, this is some fucked up shit for sure. And laugh at me. But They also know the humor side of me, if they actually know me. That is, what you did is you allowed a rapist to rape a person in the audience and then apologized to the rapist for having their victim in the audience. That would actually make you a rape apologist to the feminist movement and would promote you in supporting rape culture. Well, it's a good thing I don't actually believe in rape culture in the Western world. Well, at least in most of the Western world. Sweden's kind of became the rape culture central of the world right now. Hello, Muslims. How you doing? Rhea agreed that she would go forward and continue on as a panelist in a later panel. This is a difficult situation to build policy to alleviate, but we ask that all the people involved consider the power of our actions and statements, both online and in the real world. But one specific note, if people attend VidCon to collect footage to later use in videos that criticize not just ideas, but focus on the outrage of their followers on individuals, they will not be welcome back. Yeah, go ahead and say goodbye to all your content creator. Oh wait, that's like 90% of VidCon itself. The reason why people go to VidCon is because they are a content creator wanting to meet their fans, like Philip DeFranco. Like, there's like a lot of people there. I don't know. PewDiePie probably would have gone. Probably. But definitely Philip DeFranco, who's not even... Philip DeFranco's like a very great person in general. He's like the only biggest YouTuber I can think of who went. Sargon of Akkad went to meet his fans, mostly. You know, doesn't hurt to explore around and check out the VidCon itself. But yeah, pretty much everybody who goes to VidCon is either the content creators wanting to meet their fans, or the fans, you know, wanting to check out panels, which you're more likely, more or less, banned next year because, at this point, all panels are considered a hostile environment. We shouldn't have this happen again next year. You know, ban all the content creators because they can't get along with each other, according to you, and according to Nadia Sarkeesian and Steve Shives. And then all the fans just won't even bother showing up because their content creators are not going to be there. If about, I think, 5 content creators that YouTubers like to enjoy watching do not show up or are not allowed to go because of a ban that you've just put in, you've literally cut off people from wanting to go, period. From wanting to spend the hundreds of dollars it's going to cost for travel expenses, the money for the hotel, the money for the food, the money for merchandise to buy at the VidCon itself. All gone. So yeah, go ahead and block all content creators. I just hope I don't see Anita Sarkeesian next year at VidCon. But then again, there probably won't be a VidCon because nobody's going to want to go due to the fact that nobody's allowed to go. So yeah, great threat there to permanently shut down your event when it just started up. I think this is, I don't know how many VidCons there's been, but this has like been the biggest one because content creators that are usually against each other's opinions came together. Most of them actually came to an agreement and got along really great. Lacey Green and Sargon of Akkad are perfect examples of this. You know, Francesca Ramsey and Chris Worski, as well as Andy Worski's, as I just hit my microphone. Cat Black and pretty much every content creator that she's been spoken against about. You know, they actually do come to an agreement. It's just Anita, which ironically is a white woman, cannot seem to get over her fucking grudge and have to call out Sargon when she could have just continued on with what she was originally going to say. Or if she really felt threatened. Like, seriously, this hostile environment was so threatening to her very presence, she could have gotten up, walked away, and asked for a security escort out of the area. Literally, that's all she had to do. And you apologized to this rape apologist. You apologized to this rapist. You know, you're blaming the victim, not the victimizer. That's all I'm going to have to say before I go ahead and sign out. I'm going to have to ask you guys for one or two things. Go ahead and follow me on Twitter if you're not doing so already. I would love to talk to you guys some more. I currently have a poll going up as to what to call my fans. I personally like the term bomblings, but Bomb Squad and Team Demo have also popped up as well. If you have suggestions or, you know, other suggestions for what I should nickname my fans, then feel free to do that. I will definitely, because as soon as I find one that I like and I know I'm going to like it, I'm going to start calling you guys that because, boom, you guys are awesome for, like, at least putting up with all my rage. Also, I have a shop in below, in the description below. It will take you to my store. It is now 900% Kekistan. Like, seriously, it's mainly for women attire. I do have some men cotton squares, pocket squares, you know, the little cloths that men put in their suits for, like, business attire stuff. But hey, let's make Kekistan all about business attire. It's also got a few pillows, tapestries, scarves, and a few other items in there. As well as crab knife, because I love that fucking crab. I have no idea why. Until next time, this is Tiki Bomber signing off.